Coming up next on LATiNAS, we'll hear New York City immigrant stories, meet Broadway icon Chita Rivera, and so much more. LATiNAS starts now. Welcome to LATiNAS, the show that's all about nosotras. I'm Tinabeth Piña. Right behind me is the Statue of Liberty, the first thing millions of immigrants saw when arriving to Ellis Island at the beginning of the 20th century. New York City was and is a sanctuary city for so many seeking a better life in the United States. And now thousands of migrants continue to make their way to the Big Apple, seeking a better life for themselves and their families. Correspondent Marlene Peralta met one of those immigrants, an asylum seeker from Venezuela, in today's Prospecto Latino.
Maria Isabel Jimenez came from Venezuela about a year ago with a five-year-old son. She's among the over 50,000 asylum seekers who have arrived in New York City since the spring of 2023. She says it hasn't been easy to navigate New York City being a new immigrant with no family here.
Bueno, realmente la situación en mi país está muy difícil. Aparte, yo tengo un caso real por el cual estoy solicitando asilo político porque fui agredida varias veces por hacerle oposición al gobierno. Y entonces, por eso, realmente, por eso y por buscar una mejor calidad de vida para mí y para mi hijo, estoy acá.
We met with her at Churches United for Fair Housing, one of many nonprofit organizations providing assistance to asylum seekers finding housing and other resources.
She's currently living at a shelter that's nearby here in Williamsburg, but currently she was denied for her working papers, so the Social Security, so that will help her apply to the other things that she's trying to apply, like food stamps and other services as well. So that will be like the first thing, but the second thing is obviously the permanent housing apartment.
Maria Isabel told us that the federal government made a mistake granting her five-year-old son working papers and denying hers.
Me impacta porque realmente yo estoy esperando una buena oportunidad de empleo. Y obviamente yo tenía que solicitarlo para mi hijo porque es un tipo de identificación. Vivir en un shelter tiene muchas limitantes, pero ciertamente es el camino más idóneo si deseas adquirir una vivienda de baja renta, porque mi deseo es poder trabajar y tener una vida normal, pero no solo vivir para pagar una renta.
As we see here, over 55,300 asylum seekers have had some level of interaction with our shelter system and have been offered a place to rest at night. I know we say these numbers over and over again, but I want you to think about 55,000 people being added to our shelter system.
With no documents, Maria Isabel cannot work. While she reapplies for working papers, she has been taking English classes and volunteering at Churches United, joining protests demanding affordable housing for all.
No puedo solicitar un ITIN number porque mi pasaporte está vencido y no hay embajadas ni consulados aquí en todos Estados Unidos de Venezuela porque debido a la situación de mi país, digamos que las situaciones diplomáticas, las relaciones diplomáticas no están dadas para eso. La parte más cercana para obtener el pasaporte es México o Canadá, pero nosotros no podemos salir del país.
Despite all the hardships, all the struggles you've been through, you seem positive. Why?
Porque tengo mucha fe, es mi formación y lo agradezco mucho. Son mis principios y es mi forma de ver la vida, porque a veces no es lo que te pase, sino cómo reaccionas ante lo que te pase, la actitud que tengas. Y bueno, sí sé que hay muchas cosas que de repente no han funcionado bien, como por ejemplo que me negaran el permiso de trabajo, obviamente fue un error, pero son cosas que a la final se resuelven. Entonces tiendo a no enfocarme en los problemas, sino en las soluciones.
For LATiNAS, I am Marlene Peralta. Thank you.
Pride Month is celebrated every June, and in light of the influx of asylum seekers in New York City, we want to introduce you to the Queer Detainee Empowerment Project, a local New York City organization that assists LGBTQ immigrants in every way possible. Let's take a look.
Me he venido a este país con la única esperanza de salvaguardar mi vida.
I was tortured and they tried to kill me.
It's either I leave or I stay here and die.
Y que siento que aquí en Estados Unidos es un país libre donde puedo ser yo.
I've had my American dreams. I want to be there to be free, to be myself.
I asked him for asylum, but they sent me immediately to detention.
I was handcuffed both on my legs, my waist, my hand.
I never understand why.
La experiencia de estar en un centro de detención masculino fue una pesadilla.
Una pesadilla que hasta la fecha no la puedo superar.
A lot of people need to know what happened with immigration and also with LGBTQ+ community.
For us at QDEP, it's about like, you know, how do we shift the narratives around immigration to include queer people.
Entonces hay una luz de esperanza para que la gente allá afuera comprenda que somos esto. Seres humanos, al igual que ellos.
There's really limited resources for queer and trans immigrants in this country. Using my own personal experience and story,
we help to free others.
Cuando te dicen, no te preocupes, estamos contigo, es cuando realmente puedes respirar un poco de tranquilidad.
QDEP serve all the LGBTQ+ immigrants coming from all countries.
If you're Spanish, there's a Spanish translation for you. If you're French, there's a French one for you.
No es mi familia de sangre, pero es una familia que me estaba ayudando a saber que yo no estaba sola.
Aquí no importa el género, aquí somos hermanas, hermanos, hermanex, somos una familia.
That's one thing that is very, very unique about QDEP is that family, that love. We're not just saying it, but we're doing it.
When a woman is pregnant or has had a miscarriage or an abortion, a mixture of feelings are inevitable. The Bishop, Curandera, and Pregnancy Advocate are back one last time to share their experiences with those raw emotions in today's Caliente Caliente.
I think there's a misconception of what is miscarriage and what is an abortion. A miscarriage is God's will for this has happened, right? Baby's no longer
but inside people are mama's threatening
womb.
That.
But then they have to say that that is abortion, that that is having an abortion.
No,
like I've had, I'm from the Dominican Republic. I've had an aunt say, oh, when I had an abortion, I was like, wait, you've never had an abortion. And I was like, it was a miscarriage. Let's word it how it is.
Yes.
Because there's different surgical procedures that are done depending what is happening with the woman.
For myself, I had an ectopic pregnancy twice and I had to receive a shot that was going to release this egg, detach from my fallopian tube so that way I would not die. And the second time, okay, that procedure still didn't work and I was rushed into emergency surgery. And had I not had an abortion, I would have died.
There's a story of a woman who was pregnant and at 19 weeks, she was told that her child had no brain, had, you know, was born without a brain. And so they told her, you know, this is the only goal you have. But her husband, who was a football player, was away in another state. And while he was visiting that state, he saw a young kid that was in need of a kidney. So when he went back and told his wife, she decided, I'm going to carry the child to term and donate its organs. So there's always a way that God provides to have a solution.
I personally have doulaed two abortions where women have taken the pill, and they've come to me after they already take, because you take the first pill at the doctor's office.
And the second one at home.
And then you take the second one at home.
As I tell the women, I guide them, knowing that they're going to take the pill and that they're making this decision and I probably won't see them again. And I say to them, remember, you took this first pill. You do not have to take this second one. And if it is that you're regretting this decision because of what you're feeling, this is the number to call.
The word shame, that right there is attached to both of those things, miscarriage and abortion.
There is shaming, and you're
There's
right, that happens.
So much shame.
There's women that feel like, I can't talk to anyone about what I have done. Mm-hmm. How about opening up more and saying, I have. I don't ever want to be in that position again. I am hurt, or this is the reason why I ended up doing it. Okay, let's talk about it. We don't want you there again.
We are in a state where people don't have many morals. People don't have any thought about how to live a moral life. So So we want someone there to put these laws that doesn't have high morals about themselves, and they want to force this on women.
And I really can't see how God Almighty will be in support, again, of abortion or ending a life.
There's a spiritual side, holding to faith and holding to God, and then there's also the realities of this very human experience that we're living, especially as women.
Just last month, Ana Almanzar was appointed the Deputy Mayor for Strategic Initiatives by Mayor Eric Adams. Years ago, Almanzar moved to New York City from the Dominican Republic and turned her American dream into a reality. She most recently served as the Director of Communications for the Mother Cabrini Health Foundation and as Chief of Staff to New York State Director of Nonprofits in Governor Cuomo's Executive Chamber.
I want New Yorkers to know that you have an immigrant, Latina, who came to this city with a dream, who work in the service industry, whose first degree is from Hostos Community College. A proud CUNY school, and who understands firsthand the role government can and must play to work for hardworking people.
Ana Almanzar is today's Badass Latina.
When was the last time you saw a mainstream American play with a Latina as the main character? Can't think of any? Well, José Rivera has been writing plays with Latina leads for decades and winning awards for it. Correspondent Judith Escalona reports.
And they said no one's writing good roles for Latin women. And I was, 21 years old. I'm thinking, well, I'm going to do it. I feel like I've been challenged, and I'm going to write great roles for Latin women, period.
José Rivera met that challenge by writing over 35 plays for the theater, spanning a multi-decade career that includes two Obies and an Oscar nomination for his Motorcycle Diaries screenplay. He recently completed for Netflix the television adaptation of 100 Years of Solitude by Nobel Prize winner Gabriel Garcia Marquez. While faithful to the book, Rivera made revisions that fleshed out the female characters.
The fans will hate me for saying this, but there's a lot of misogyny in that work. And a lot of the women are whores or virgins, saints or whores, you know? And so I needed to give some of the women some agency. So wherever I could, I created moments for the women to respond and to act.
Rivera universalizes Latinas, addressing issues normally explored by mainstream characters. He also presents other racial and ethnic groups interacting with one another. Most of his Latino characters occupy spaces that are normative, identifiably American. Only their names and occasional use of Spanish provide markers of ethnicity. In Marisol, for example, the main character is a Latina urban professional.
Yeah, Marisol is based a lot on me. I mean, I lived in the Bronx. I used to work for a science publisher downtown on Spring Street. I used to commute every day. I got attacked by a guy with a golf club. I got attacked by a guy with an ice cream cone. The point is, though, that at the end of that play, two women of color are the heroes, a black woman and a Puerto Rican woman. That is not something we had seen before.
Flaca is Rivera's new Latina heroine in Takeover, his screenplay about the young lords that Ángel Manuel Soto of the Transformers franchise will direct.
Yeah, Flaca is Flaca. Flaca's me. Another woman, that's me. When I was beginning to write it, I thought, how am I going to enter this story? Because I wasn't there. But then I said to myself, well, if I had grown up in New York at the time, given how conservative my father was especially, he would have forbidden me to join the Young Lords. I said, that's how I'm going to. Flaca is that character who comes from a conservative family where, as an immigrant, you can't speak up. You have to keep your head down. You respect authority. That's the context I grew up in. That's the context Flaca lives in. And then she has to break through, you know, that shell and become her own person and become part of the Young Lords.
Rivera speaks through his women characters. They're thinking what he's thinking. For example, in his play titled References to Salvador Dali Make Me Hot, Gabriela worries that the Gulf War has changed her husband. In his latest semi-autobiographical work, The Hours Are Feminine, Evalise, his mother's character, befriends an Italo-American woman, crossing language and cultural barriers.
I had just an extraordinary mother who was a great storyteller, who, you know, had 9 children in 11 years and, you know, held us together, and a very strong sister who was a nurse, and women in my family, cousins and aunts, who were really strong people living in very difficult circumstances. And yet I saw these women sort of rise up every time, you know, to sort of claim some kind of selfhood, you know? And I thought that was heroic.
Whether it's theater, film, or television, José Rivera continues to provide the American cultural landscape with a unique vision, where women have a commanding presence that surprisingly has its roots in Puerto Rico, filtered through the American experience. I'm Judith Escalona for LATiNAS.
Dominicana Linedy Genao is known as the first Latina to star in an Andrew Lloyd Webber musical when she was cast last year in the lead role of Bad Cinderella on Broadway. Correspondent Elena Romero headed to the Imperial Theater before the show's final curtain call earlier this month to speak with this Latina on the rise.
We all grew up with the story of Cinderella, a rags-to-riches fairy tale. For 31-year-old actress Linedy Genao, Cinderella's story hits close to home.
Growing up, I didn't have a Disney movie or a princess that I could relate to that looked like me, sounded like me, had a name like me. So to be that, even for one person, means more than I could ever express.
Genao, who grew up singing in church, discovered theater in high school.
Since I was a baby, music has been a part of my life. I auditioned for some schools, didn't get in, thought I wasn't good enough, and I was like, you know what, that's fine, I'll study business, I'll still keep the arts alive in my life through my community. And I was working at my bank job, and a friend sent me the audition for the Gloria Estefan musical that they were looking for Latinos, and I was like, let me try.
She went from banking to Broadway in 2015 when she attended an open call for On Your Feet, the musical based on the life of Gloria and Emilio Estefan.
So with high school theater experience and a headshot that I took on my iPhone 4 as a selfie, I went to the open call and I made my Broadway debut with high school theater experience. So all of this has been a dream come true because it's never anything I expected, and just a testament that, you know, lo que pa ti nadie te lo quita.
Since then, Genao has appeared on Broadway in Dear Evan Hansen and in regional productions of West Side Story and In the Heights. Although Bad Cinderella ended its Broadway run this past month, Genao told me how proud she was to have landed the role and how she brought a lot of herself into it.
My version of the Cinderella is very much Latina. Again, in my mannerisms, like I move my eyebrows a lot when I speak, my hands, the inflections in my voice and some of the joke lines. And I've really embraced that. My Brooklyn accent comes out of nowhere sometimes.
In case you were wondering, the former Cinderella found her Prince Charming on her Broadway debut.
So what advice would you give women who are looking for their happily ever after?
Ooh. Let me tell you, it comes when you least expect it, because I wanted nothing to do with having a partner at all. And you can't plan for that sometimes. Like, I need this, I need this. You're gonna have to know you need to compromise. You're never gonna find the perfect person that checks off every box, and trust that it'll come when it's meant to.
For LATiNAS, I'm Elena Romero.
In her new memoir, written with my fellow CUNY TV host Patrick Pacheco, 90-year-old Broadway icon Chita Rivera reflects on everything she has learned from her family to Leonard Bernstein, Bob Fosse, and everyone else in between. And I was lucky enough to sit down with this Inspiracion Latina. Why a memoir? Why now?
Why not?
Okay.
It's time. It's time. It's time I shared. It's mainly for young kids, you know, to get courage, to work hard, and maybe this can happen to them.
Sure, sure. You know, so. Is it important to you to specifically inspire Latinas? Because in the business, there's never really been a lot of Latino representation.
Yes, it is. It's very important now. When I started out, I was just me. The older I get, the more I feel responsible for Latinas.
Now, it's no coincidence that you picked the iconic Anita dress photo from West Side Story as the cover of your book, because it means so many different things to you.
It identifies me. It is the first of many roles that I performed, but it was the very first one with Jerome Robbins and Stephen Sondheim and Leonard Bernstein and Arthur Lawrence and an amazing cast of characters. And it was the introduction of West Side to the world.
And I learned reading the book that you, when you saw Rita Moreno in the film wearing the dress, you were like, that's my dress.
That's right. it wasn't that my part. It was, that's my dress. But she had on two earrings and I only had one. So I noticed that too.
How awesome is it that you've had such great honor and opportunities to work with so many wonderful people in the business and to create so many iconic roles? For me, being here today, I'm here because of somebody like you. I'm standing on the shoulders of someone like you. Because if it wasn't for you, you know, being on Broadway and blazing a path for other women, for other Latinas.
Thank you.
I wouldn't be here today doing what I do.
Well, that's extraordinary to say that. And if that's true, I thank you for it. But I came along at a great, great time. And I took advantage of that time and that opportunity. And I was lucky. I took advantage of the opportunity, and here we are. Here we are.
Here we are. And what would Dolores Conchita Figueroa del Rivero think now, 90 years later,
ooh,
having
ooh,
this memoir? I know. Ooh. I know. It's crazy.
Ooh. Oh, she would think. She would think that I did a good job. I did a good job. And it's a relief to see it sitting in the middle of this table all by itself, with the exception of you.
It's not there anymore.
But it's enabling me to continue my life, you know, and know that I have done something.
And that's our show for today. For more information on what you just saw, check out our website at tv.cuny.edu and follow our social media profiles, because we love sharing our Latina stories with you. And please make sure you tune in next time for even more amazing stories about who else? Latinas. ¡Uepa! Hasta la próxima. Bye-bye.